Drahí priatelia, veľmi sa teším, že vás opäť môžem privítať v našom štúdiu na Manhattane v našej relácii americko-slovenské inšpirácie. Hi everyone, I'm very excited I can again welcome you in our studio here in Manhattan with the show American Slovak Inspirations. Mojím dnešným vzácnym hosťom je kňaz, umelec a človek, ktorý sa podelí o svedectvo v oboch týchto oblastiach svojho života. My today's valued guest is a priest, but also an artist, and he's going to speak about both of these vocations. It's Father Frank Sabete. Welcome here.
Thank you.
Ďakujem. Ja ďakujem aj vám, že ste s nami. Thank you too that you're with us. A vďaka tomu, že sa spájame naživo v rovnakom čase. Thanks to the fact that we are live, that means we are connected in real time. Uvidíte na svojich obrazovkách kontakty, kam nám môžete zasielať buď pozdravy, pripomienky alebo otázky. So on the screens you will see contact information where you can send either questions or just greetings or whatever you feel like telling us. Otec Frank, Father Frank, I would like to ask you at the very beginning, what was your way to New York City? Ako ste sa vy dostali do New Yorku?
Well, in 2006, the Paulist Fathers, that I'm a member of the Paulist Fathers Religious Order, asked me if I would come to New York and start something for artists. It could be whatever I wanted. It was a, you know, a Paulist Fathers project, and also to continue doing my own art. And even though I didn't want to go to New York, I didn't want to live in New York, I'm a Californian, I couldn't say no. It was really a wonderful opportunity. And so I did. I came here and started the outreach to artists, which I've been doing ever since. And also, 2 years ago, I became the senior curator of the gallery at the Sheen Center.
Takže v roku 2006 ma moji spolubratia, keďže patrím do rádu Paulínov, požiadali, aby som šiel do New Yorku, aby som začal taký projekt, ktorý som mal vlastne ja sám vyformovať a mal sa teda týkať dialogu s umelcami. A hoci ja, pochádzajúc z Kalifornie, som nemal chuť ísť do New Yorku na začiatku, bola to príležitosť, ktorá sa neodmieta, pretože mi to dalo šancu nielen teda spolupracovať s umelcami, ale takisto pokračovať v tvorbe môjho vlastného umenia a takisto pred dvoma rokmi som sa začala zapájať aj do tzv. Sheen Center, kde sa podielam práve na galériách a na výstavách v galériách. Možno, že som predsa len mala začať inak. Maybe I should have started differently. Možno, že som sa vás predsa mala spýtať na prvé z vašich povolaní, a to je kňazstvo. Maybe I should have started with the first vocation in your life, and that's the priesthood, I guess.
Yes. Well,
tak, aká bola tá cesta? What was this journey first? Because it connects, I guess.
That's the first journey. Well, artist was first, and then priest was followed. But when I was an art student at UCLA, University of California, Los Angeles, I met the Paulist Fathers who ran the Catholic Center. And I had, like any Catholic boy in my generation, I had thought of being a priest, but kind of put it aside. And then I met them and saw how human they were, how down to earth, and I related to them. And they were also wonderful preachers. And I got to know them and started to think again about being a priest. And also I saw that they were a very creative order. They also valued an individual's talents. So I knew my art interest would not disappear or would not be. It's been ever since then, it's all been true that the Paulists have really been amazing and really making use of my gifts. And I've given some back.
I will definitely talk about it more. Keď som študoval na univerzite v Kalifornii, v Los Angeles, umenie, tak ako pomerne veľa chlapcov mojej generácie, som sa zamýšľal trochu nad tým, že či by som sa nemal stať kňazom, ale tak som to odkladal, až kým som stretol vlastne bratov Paulínov a na nich ma najviac oslovila taká ich ľudskosť, že boli nohami na zemi, ako sa hovorí, a takisto bolo pre mňa veľmi dôležité, že som vnímal, že v ich ráde veľmi rešpektujú individualitu každého jedného člena a vedel som, že moja láska k umeniu by nebola potlačená, naopak, že by dostala priestor, a presne tak sa to aj stalo, a aj vďaka tomu, že som sa stal ich súčasťou, môžem sa venovať svojmu umeniu a jeho rozvíjaniu. Je úžasné, ako ste spomenuli, že vaše umenie nebolo potlačené. It's wonderful, as you mentioned, that your artistic skills were not suppressed. On the contrary, you could work on that. Ešte ma ale zaujalo, keď ste spomenuli, že vás fascinovala ich ľudskosť. čo robí človeka ľudským? Je to trochu taká teoretická otázka. What caught my attention when you mentioned that you loved about them how human they were. Mm. What makes a person human? I know it's a little theoretical, but still, it's so important in our faith, right? So, what did it feel like that they were so human?
I think because I felt a kinship at some level that
as a connection,
as a flawed human being myself, mm-hmm. I could finally see that priests were flawed human beings, mm. just like any of us. That was the initial connection, mm-hmm. because before I always thought of priests as being somehow higher than human.
Okay. Myslím si, že to bolo práve také spojenie a také partnerstvo v tom, že ja ako ľudská bytosť so slabosťami som konečne videl kňazov ako mne rovných v zmysle, že aj oni sú ľudské bytosti a majú slabosti, pretože predtým som napríklad vnímal kňazov ako keby boli niekde vyššie a nejaké iné bytosti a ich taká tá ľudskosť, tá pokora ma práve oslovila v tom, že sme v tom vlastne všetci spolu. A teraz sa môžeme dostať k vášmu umeniu. Now we can go back to your art a little bit. Vy ste povedali na začiatku, že to bola prvá cesta. You at the very beginning mentioned that that was the first journey. That was the first vocation. Mm. Takže kedy to u vás začalo a ako si vás začal Boh používať ako svoj nástroj v umení? So when did it start in your own life and how did God start to create his artistic tool out of you?
Mm. Well, when I was about 12, I discovered I could draw. Mm-hmm. And it was just very simply, I copied a magazine picture photo and found out I could do it. And it was surprised me. And after that, I loved drawing and wanted to develop it more and, mm-hmm. and learn more about it. Mm-hmm. I should mention, too, that as any good Catholic boy, I did think of being a priest at the time, too. But I thought at the time, I remember telling my mother, I think I'm too young for this now.
So, so you wanted to take your time?
I take my time.
Začalo to tým, že ako malý chlapec, alebo mladý chlapec, 12-ročný, som zistil, že vlastne viem kresliť. A začalo to tak veľmi jednoducho, z nejakého časopisu som niečo obkreslil a povedal som si, wow, ok, tak toto môžem robiť. A pokračoval som v tom. A ako dobrý katolický chlapec, ako som už spomenul, som sa samozrejme zamýšľal aj nad tým, že by som sa mohol stať kňazom, ale povedal som si, že ešte som na to mladý. Potom to však prišlo, then it came. You were no longer young for that. Neboli ste preto príliš mladí. Avšak ja viem, že okrem kreslenia sa venujete aj iným typom umenia. Tak trochu nám to prosím približte. I know, however, that apart from drawing, you yourself do also other stuff in your artistic world. So what is it, please?
Well, I direct a collective of artists. What I do when I got to New York, what I did was I started to visit young artists, particularly graduate students, mm-hmm. Who were getting their advanced degrees. And I went to all the different schools and got to know them. I formed a team. The team has been coming up with various ways to have exhibits and to connect with artists. So I do that. I have a background in organization. I'm good at organizing people, leadership training, and so on.
Mm-hmm. Takže keď som prišiel do New Yorku a začal som teda toto dielo, na ktoré som sem bol poslaný, alebo tú misiu, začal som navštevovať rôzne štúdia alebo univerzity, kde som sa jednoducho začal rozprávať so študentami, ktorí si sa venovali svojmu magisterskému štúdiu alebo vyššiemu stupňu štúdia práve v umení. Takisto som vybudoval okolo seba tým ľudí, ktorí potom prichádzali s rôznymi kreatívnymi spôsobmi, ako organizovať výstavy, organizovať ľudí a venovať sa aj takzvanému líderstvu je pre mňa blízke, pretože som sa tomu venoval vlastne aj v minulosti, takže takto to potom pokračovalo. Z tejto jedinej odpovede by som najradšej položila ďalších 5 otázok. Just from what you just said leads me to 5 other questions I would like to ask you. Ale chcem sa spýtať, ako si spomínate na tie začiatky, na tie rozhovory so študentami, čo ste sa možno cez to naučili, v čom ste vyrástli a začali ste to robiť inak. I would like to go to the beginnings of you meeting artists. Mm-hmm. What was the journey like? What did you learn? What did you decide to do differently? Yes. And so on. I'm sure you grow in that. So.
Yes. Well, when I first started, what I would do is I would go, like I say, they have open studios which are when the schools open the graduate students' studios to the public. Mm-hmm. And I would go and just go from one studio to the next. I would ask the artists to tell me about what was moving them in their work, tell me about their work. I didn't go there to judge art, mm-hmm. but to meet the artist. Mm-hmm. And then we would start having a conversation. Then I would introduce myself, and then, you know, there were many times when I would see them again at another opening, mm-hmm. or a thesis show. Okay. That's how I started. Mm-hmm.
Takže, ako som už spomenul, tie tzv. Otvorené štúdia, to sa dialo, keď univerzitní študenti mali vlastne svoje štúdio otvorené pre verejnosť a vďaka tomu som mohol ísť, mohol som ich stretnúť, predstaviť sa. Neprichádzal som ako znalec umenia posudzovať ich umenie, prišiel som stretnúť človeka a vďaka tomu som mohol vlastne s nimi viesť dialog a začať sa rozprávať o tom, čo by sme mohli aj spolu podniknúť. Vy ste mi pred reláciou krátko spomenuli príbeh, ako ste sa ale naučili, že je dôležité naozaj stretnúť človeka v prvom rade. But shortly before our show, before we started to be live, you mentioned to me a very nice story, how you learned that it's important to really meet the yes. person themselves.
Yes, that it was a lesson to me on what real discipleship means, what really reaching out to others means. And so I went to visit artists, and it was one of the schools, and went to the open studios. And what since I was starting this program, I wanted to really make it work. So mm-hmm. I wanted to recruit people in a mm-hmm. sense, and kind of sell the program. Well, I was talking to this one young woman, this one artist, and I said, you know, talked about the art. And then I said, well, you know, I'm starting this program, and do you have a business card, and so on. As soon as I stepped out of her studio, I realized that somehow she knew that I cared more about my program mm. than her. And it hit me. It's like it was an awakening. And I took the idea of building my program and threw it out, knowing that would be fine, but I threw it out. And to me then, from that moment, all that mattered was that person standing in front of me.
Mm. That's a wonderful lesson to learn, right?
It's essential to anyone who does any kind of caring profession. Mm-hmm.
Áno, je to príbeh, kedy som teda bol v jednom z týchto štúdií, stredol som mladú umelkyňu a vlastne som sa jej pýtal, čo robí, čomu sa venuje. Povedal som, že začínam takýto a takýto program, dal som jej svoju vlastne vizitku, pýtal som si jej vizitku. V podstate som sa pokúšal predať to, čomu som sa venoval, pretože mi leželo na srdci, aby sa to správne rozbehlo, aby to bolo vlastne úspešné. A len čo som odišiel zo štúdia, som si uvedomil, táto mladá žena vedela veľmi dobre, že prichádzam s nejakou agendou, že prichádzam kvôli niečomu, nie kvôli nej samej. A veľmi ma to zasiahlo mňa samého, bola to pre mňa lekcia do života. Odvtedy som si povedal, najdôležitejšie je prísť a stretnúť daného človeka v danom momente, byť tam pre neho. To bola pre mňa lekcia, ako byť učeníkom, ako skutočne výjsť v ústrety k ľuďom, ak im chceme niečo odovzdať. Vy ste takisto spomenuli, ale viete čo? Nie. Najskôr si pustíme krátky klip, aby sme ukázali ľuďom umenie, ktorému sa venujete vy. I wanted to start another question, but I decided that it's time to show your artwork to people who are watching us, and afterwards we'll be back in our studio. Tak nech sa páči. Vítajte späť v našom štúdiu. Welcome back to our studio. Ja som veľmi rada, že otázku po klipe, v ktorom ste mohli vidieť umenie môjho dnešného hostia, nemusím položiť ja, ale položila ju jedna naša diváčka. I'm very happy that after people had a chance to see your art, I'm not the one who will ask the question. One of people who are watching us is asking these questions. And that's, do you feel that you're showing God drawing attention to God through your art? And do you consider, I'm translating from Slovak, do you consider your art as a tool for evangelization?
All of the above, yes.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that all artists express something of the ground of being, of God.
Mm-hmm.
Even if they're not conscious of it. My art, even the work that's not especially particularly religious, I think what great art does, what good art, even good art, I wouldn't say mine is great, I'd say it's good, but is it starts a conversation.
Mm-hmm.
When you encounter a great work of art, the conversation never ends. It's ongoing. And evangelization means evangelion is to bring the gospel, mm-hmm. is to carry the gospel. The people I have visited are people who are either alienated from the church or suspicious of institutional religion or so on, a lot of that. By asking them to tell me about their work, it's like Jesus encountering the woman at the well.
Mm-hmm.
The first words out of his mouth are not, "Were you at the temple?" They were, "Give me a drink."
Mm-hmm.
That's what I ask the artists. And that, I believe, is bringing the gospel.
Mm-hmm. Odpoveď na všetky otázky, za ktoré mimochodom ďakujeme, je áno. Myslím si, že každý umelec, či už je si toho vedomý alebo nie, nejakým spôsobom zobrazuje určitý aspekt Boha. A to je veľmi dôležité a každé umenie, každé dobré umenie vzbudzuje otázky, vzbudzuje alebo inšpiruje k dialogu. Keď prídete do kontaktu s nejakým fantastickým umeleckým dielom, tak ten dialog je nekonečný, nikdy vlastne nekončí. A to je aj moja skúsenosť, to je to, čo ja vnímam, že urobil Ježiš sám, keď stretol ženu pri studni. Jeho prvá otázka nebola, bola si dnes v chráme. Jeho otázka, alebo teda to, čo povedal, bolo, daj sa mi napiť. Daj mi prosím napiť. A to vnímam, že aj ja sa pokúšam robiť s umelcami. Poprosím ich, aby mne dali napiť. Poprosím ich, aby mi predstavili svoje umelecké dielo. Nedá mi vďaka tomu, čo ste teraz spomenuli, položiť takú možno trochu provokačnú otázku. Thanks to what you just mentioned, I would like to ask a question to provoke an answer. A tá otázka znie, je podľa vás dobre rozdeľovať striktne umenie, toto je náboženské umenie a toto je svetské umenie? Is it a good idea to draw this line very strictly and say this is a religious art and this is religious art and this is secular art? What do you think about that?
Well, some art is more iconography in the sense that it depicts religious images.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is when you say that secular art is bad and religious art is good.
Mm-hmm.
Then you've created a dichotomy. Then you've created a separation, which is not helpful.
Mm-hmm.
Much of the art that I've experienced and much of the art that's in our exhibits is what people would call contemporary or secular art.
Mm-hmm.
And over again, that has put young people in touch with the sacred, with God, really, mm-hmm. even if they're not initially aware of it.
Samozrejme, niektoré typy umenia sú vyslovene náboženské, ako je napríklad ikonografia. Hej, tam sa to nedá poprieť. Ale na druhej strane, ako náhle sa vyjadríme, že náboženské umenie je dobré, a sekulárne alebo svetské umenie až také dobre nie je, vzbudzujeme rozdelenie, ktoré určite nie je správne. A to je moja skúsenosť aj z našich výstav, je to skúsenosť aj možno z mojich diel, že ľudia, ktorí prichádzajú, sa cítia dotknutí Bohom, či už si to na začiatku uvedomia alebo nie, či už stoja pred niečím, čo by sa dalo označiť ako náboženské umenie, alebo pred niečím, čo bežne môžeme označiť ako svetské. Vy máte veľmi veľa skúseností s tzv. Budovaním mostov a ja vás chcem pozvať, aby ste mi k tomu povedali viac, lebo to sa týka aj toho, ako vaše výstavy prebiehajú a kto sú tí umelci. You have a lot of wonderful experience from building the bridges. Mm-hmm. And it goes all back to what the exhibitions look like and how they work and who the artists are. Mm-hmm. So if you could tell us a little more about that, please.
The exhibits that we have been over the years, so this is 13 years, have been a whole range of artists, but primarily I would say recent graduate students from different schools and so on, as well as some older artists and some more accomplished artists and so on. And they have all, they've exhibited in the church, and what we keep hearing from them is that they can't believe that they've been invited to show their work in a church, that because for much of their lives, they're told, why do you want to waste your time doing art? Mm-hmm. And they've been told that by religious people a lot of times. And we're saying, no, you have a voice. You have something to tell us about our world and about where we are and where we're going. And that really, it touches them. Now, what the results of that are, only God knows. But then again, a disciple is someone who sows seeds, and that's all they do.
That's a very good point. Umelci, alebo teda naše výstavy prebiehajú tak, že vystavujú svoje diela umelci väčšinou, ktorí práve skončili svoje štúdia, ale potom máme samozrejme aj umelcov, ktorí sú už dlhoročnými vystavovateľmi alebo majú viacej skúseností. A veľakrát tá skúsenosť je práve taká, že keď sú ľudia pozvaní, aby mali výstavu v našom kostole, tak sú z toho v šoku a sú takí, že no moja životná skúsenosť je iná. Celý život mi hovorili, prečo chcem strácať čas umením. A veľakrát to hovorili práve aj veriaci ľudia. A my naopak sa im snažíme povedať, nie, nie, vy máte hlas v svojom vnútri, ktorý chce niečo povedať, ktorý je povolaný niečo povedať, odkiaľ prichádzate, kam idete. A na druhej strane je veľmi dôležité spomenúť aj to, že my ako učeníci sme pozvaní zasievať. Ale to je všetko. To Boh dáva rast vlastne a on rozhodne, ako to pôjde ďalej. Ja viem, že takéto výstavy sú predmetom aj medzináboženského dialógu a chcela by som sa toho trochu dotknúť. I know that your exhibits also create a space for the interreligious dialogue. Mm-hmm. I would like to speak a little bit about that.
Yes. We at any of our receptions for the exhibits, we've had a whole range of people. We have Catholics, we've had Buddhists, we've had Hindus, we've had non-Catholics, we've had everything, all talking to one another. We also had an exhibit at one time of seven Islamic artists showing devotional work, so work mm-hmm. about God. And some people hated it. But the most faithful Catholics I know loved it mm-hmm. because they were able to have a conversation with people who have a different perspective, but they saw it as, they saw the unity in it. Mm-hmm. So yes, we've had over and again experiences of people who would never interacting.
Wonderful. Áno, naše výstavy tvoria umelci, ktorí sú často katolíci, sú budhisti, sú hinduisti, sú moslimovia a vytvárame tým priestor, aby sa títo ľudia stretli, aby vytvorili dialog a spájame tak ľudí, ktorí by možno inak nikdy medzi sebou neviedli konverzáciu. A moja skúsenosť je taká, že mali sme výstavu asi 7 umelcov, ktorí sa venovali teda vyjadreniu, náboženskému vyjadreniu islamu a veľmi hlboko veriaci katolíci, ktorí prišli na túto výstavu, s nimi mali nádherný rozhovor a prebehlo také úžasné spojenie medzi tými ľuďmi. Bolo to práve preto, že napriek rozdielom a rozdielným perspektívam hľadali to, čo ich spája a to, čo vytvára medzi nimi jednotu. A o to nám vlastne ide ponúkať takýto priestor dialogu. Prečo si myslíte, že my ľudia máme tendenciu rozdeľovať namiesto toho, aby sme hľadali, čo nás spája? What do you think is the reason behind our behavior as human beings, weak human beings, that we often need to separate things and divide and look more on what divides us rather than what unites us? What do you think, how does it work in us?
When my identity, who I think I am, sometimes I think what we do is we require the need to put ourselves over and against another for our own understanding of who we are. In other words, like in religion and faith and so on, I think that a sign of false religion is when I have the need to be, to have an enemy, for there to be a wicked other, for there to be people that I point to and say, they are bad, I am good. Mm-hmm. That's not faith, not at all. Mm-hmm. That is the human propensity toward rivalry, mm-hmm. which I believe is actually the ultimate sin in many ways. Mm.
Je to v niečom v našej ľudskej prirodzenosti, že máme potrebu sa často povyšovať a dať niekomu pocítiť, či už priamo alebo nepriamo, že sme lepší, alebo niečo je správnejšie ako to iné. A myslím si osobne, že to korení v hriechu, že to má koreň v hriechu teda a že je to koreňom mnohých hriechov, keď sa snažíme o tzv. Rivalitu a keď mnohé možno skupiny ľudí veriacich majú neustálu potrebu mať nepriateľa, mať niekoho zlého, proti komu treba bojovať. Ja osobne si nemyslím, že to je viera, že to je skutočná viera. To je naozaj naša potreba sa povyšovať a to nie je spôsob, ako žiť svoju vieru. A vy ste mi k tomu spomenuli jeden veľmi pekný príbeh o vystupovaní na horu. You mentioned to me, speaking about this topic, a very wonderful story about climbing up a mountain. I would like to ask you to tell it to people who are watching us.
This story is from Brother David Stendelrast, a book that he wrote some years ago. Catholic teacher and spiritual guide. And he says that if you really enter into the depths of your religious tradition, of your religion, so if a Catholic really dives into the spiritual dimension, the aspect, and then you have, it's like climbing a mountain. Mm-hmm. So the Catholic is climbing this end, and the Buddhist is climbing here, and the Hindu is here, and the Muslim is here, and the Jew is here, and they're climbing. And they're digging into the depths of their faith. When they reach the top of the mountain, the saints recognize each other. So that in the most realized people I have known, the most realized Catholics, the people who I consider to be people of great faith, have always had a whole range of friends, irregardless of what their religion is, without the need to change them, which might upset some people. But I think that if you meet people where they are, God does any changing that is needed.
Áno, jeden benediktínsky mních práve spomenul tento príbeh alebo toto prirovnanie, že keď ľudia viery, akéhokoľvek vierovýznania, idú skutočne k podstate svojej viery a idú do hĺbky, tak je to ako keby taká hora, na ktorú katolíci vystupujú týmto smerom a budhisti týmto smerom a hinduisti týmto smerom a všetky rôzne náboženstva. A keď prídu na vrchol, tak svetci sa navzájom rozoznajú. A to je aj moja skúsenosť životná, že ľudia, ktorých ja považujem za ľudí hlbokej viery, väčšinou majú širokú paletu priateľov, ktorí môžu pochádzať z rôznych vierovýznaní, s rôznymi názormi, svetonázormi a nemajú potrebu ich meniť. Ja osobne si myslím, že keď doprajeme to, že stretneme človeka a prebehne také skutočné stretnutie, tak Boh je ten, ktorý, ak je potrebná nejaká zmena, tak on sám ju cez to stretnutie môže vykonať. To je krásny príklad. Ja vám zaň veľmi pekne ďakujem. It's a wonderful story to mention. I like it very much. Vy ste takisto mi spomenuli pred reláciou, že ste sa venovali aj študentom a že ste boli na kampuse. You mentioned to me before the show also that you were with the young adults a lot at the campus of a university. Mm-hmm. A že ste sa takisto venovali budovaniu líderstva pre nich. That one of the things you did was to create good environment for leaders to grow. Mňa k tomu napadlo, ako vy vnímate Ježiša ako lídra. How do you see Jesus as a leader? What do you admire about him and his leadership?
Wow.
At least people see we don't have every question prepared in advance.
Yes, no, I think that he enabled people to see what they had in themselves and in others that they couldn't see before. That I think that, you know, I mean, Peter is a great example. That here was someone who thought he knew what the answer was and he was, you know, ready to do this and that. But Jesus by loving him, got him to the point where he failed, but believed that God was forgiveness, which I think is, you know, and then he became the greatest of saints. So how was Jesus a leader? He was a servant leader. He was a servant leader. He washed their feet. I think the washing of the feet was the example of the kind of leader he was and what he wanted his disciples to be.
Myslím si, že Ježišovo líderstvo a to, ako viedol ľudí, spočíva práve v tom, že im pomohol objavovať v sebe samých to, čo predtým nevideli, to, čo iní na nich nevideli. A krásnym príkladom toho je svätý Peter, dnes svätý Peter, ktorý vlastne v zásade ho Ježiš zmenil tým, že ho miloval. A priviedol ho do štádia, kedy zlyhal a bolo to pre jeho život potrebné, aby to videl. Ale napriek tomu sa z neho následne stalo to, čo sa stalo a je pre nás veľmi dôležitý aj v dejinách našej viery. A povedal by som, že Ježiš bol ten, ktorý viedol tým, že slúžil. A krásnym príkladom opäť je to, že umýval svojim učeníkom nohy. A to myslím si, že vystihuje to, akým spôsobom on viedol ľudí a ako im vlastne slúžil. Vy ste mi povedali ešte pred reláciou tak krásnu vec o tom, aké to je, keď máme k niečomu povolanie. Another thing I would love to ask you to mention is you told me how it is or what it is like when we really have a calling to something.
Mm-hmm.
What it's like. How can you tell that art is a hobby for someone and it's a calling for another one? Ako rozlíšime, že pre niekoho je umenie len možno hobby alebo záľuba a pre niekoho je to naozaj povolanie?
It's a calling when you have to do it.
Povolanie to je vtedy, keď viete, že to musíte robiť.
Mm-hmm.
So it kind of, in a most positive sense, bothers you if you don't,
yes.
Right? Takže keď to náhodou nerobíte, alebo to popierate v sebe, tak vás to niekde vnútri ruší. Ale takisto je veľmi dôležité vedieť, odísť možno do samoty, čo robila Ježiš. It's also very important though to find some special time for your art and go to silence as Jesus did the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I know you have an option for artists as Paulist priests. A viem, že vy ponúkate takúto možnosť umelcom. Ako to je?
That I have an option as a Paul... I'm sorry.
It's about the residency that you mentioned,
yes,
to me.
So the Paulist Fathers we have, my program has a residency every summer at the summer house of the Paulist Fathers in Lake George, New York.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where we have artists come up there. They can apply and then they're selected. And they spend the week working on their work, talking to each other, enjoying the meals, having discussions, and that's what they do. This place, Lake George, St. Mary's, is very old. It was where our founder spent a lot of time. And it's a very sacred place for us. And it has a real spiritual power.
Mm-hmm.
There's no question about it. We do have daily mass. But many of these artists are not Catholic. I don't know even what they are, but the place always has an impact on them.
Mm-hmm. Áno, my ako náš rád máme dom, alebo teda miesto hlboko v prírode, kde veľa času trávil práve náš zakladateľ a je to teda miesto, ktoré je pre nás určitým spôsobom posvetné, samozrejme slavia sa tam sväté omše, ale neznamená to, že tam prichádzajú len katolíci. Veľakrát neviem, aké vierovýznanie a či vôbec majú vierovýznanie umelci, ktorí tam prichádzajú, ale teda môžu podať prihlášku a majú šancu prísť na týždeň a venovať sa naplno svojmu umeniu, ale zároveň mať s nami rôzne diskusie, zažívať s nami dialog. Je samozrejme šanca ísť na svätú omšu, ale je to v takej veľkej slobode. Ale naša skúsenosť je, že to ľudí vždy ovplyvní a vždy to má na ich životy určitý dopad. Máme posledné dve minútky relácie. There are two more minutes in our show. Takže by som sa vás chcela spýtať, možno, že nás pozerá niekto, kto má veľkú túžbu tvoriť umenie a cíti to ako povolanie, ale možno ho brzdí strach, možno niečo iné. Maybe there is someone out there watching us right now who feels the calling in a way and is like, I know I should make art, I should be an artist, but there is, I don't know, fear or something that's blocking that person. Do you have any type of advice? Máte akúkoľvek radu alebo inšpiráciu? Any inspiration for them?
Art is prayer. it can be prayer. An artist enters into liminal space, just like a contemplative. It takes you out of yourself, and in that sense, connects you with God. Mm-hmm. So do it for that sense. Do it as prayer, not as obligation, not as with the idea that you're going to become famous or rich or sell anything, but because God is calling you to have a conversation.
Hmm. Umenie je modlitba. Alebo teda môže byť modlitbou a môže byť modlitbou a spojením s Bohom. Takže by som pozbudil vás, pustite sa do tvorby umenia v tomto zmysle. Nie preto, že chcete niečo predať, niečo vytvoriť, stať sa slávnym. Naopak, pustite sa do umenia alebo tvorte, pretože Boh vás pozýva do dialógu, do konverzácie. Myslím si, že krajší záver sme našej relácii ani nemohli dať. I don't think there could be any more wonderful ending of our show. Chcem vám veľmi pekne poďakovať za svedectvo vášho života, za všetko, čo robíte pre umelcov. I would like to thank you very much for the testimony of your own life and everything you do for artists.
Thank you very much, and it was an honor.
Ďakujem veľmi pekne, mne bolo cťou, aj nám bolo cťou byť s vami a tešíme sa na vás na budúce. It was an honor for us too, not only to have our guest, but also to have you as our viewers, and we are looking forward to another show.